نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي اللهم فقهنا في الدين اللهم ألهمنا رشدا وعيذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه اللهم أرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه آمين ثم آمين. Surah Al-Hujrat. This surah was revealed in Medina. And this is the last of the three surahs revealed in Medina, which we have been talking about in the fifth group of the surahs of Quran. It has 18 verses and two stanzas, and being the 49th according to the order of arrangement and the 106th by the order of revolution. The surah takes its name from verse number 4, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned about Al-Hujurat, the apartments of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Ummahatul Mumineen. Regarding the period of revolution, the traditions and also the subject matter of the surah, it supports that this surah is a collection of commandments and instructions which were sent down on different occasions. Like the verse number 4 has been sent down. These were the verses which were sent down when people of Banu Tamim, their deputation arrived in Medina and they started calling out to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam from outside the apartment. So they were taught the manner to address Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Similarly, the verse number 6, we learn from a large number of traditions that these verses, they were sent down when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had sent Walid bin Utbah to collect zakat from Bani Mustalik. And so there are the different verses, they have been sent down in different periods. Now, regarding the subject matter and the topics of the surah is that the basic surah, the topic of the basic topic of the surah is to teach the Muslims the manners which are actually worthy of true believers. The first five verses, they have been taught, the Muslims have been taught the manners we should observe regarding Allah and His Messenger. And then it's been explained that in the next few verses has been told what attitude we need to adopt regarding other Muslims in case when there is a mutual disagreement or a fight between two Muslims. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has exhorted to safeguard ourselves against the evils of ill manners and bad manners, because they will corrupt the collective life and they will spoil the mutual relationship, like calling out by bad names and backbiting and slandering and taunting and hurting and mocking people. So all these ill manners or bad conduct has been negated for the Muslims. And after this, the national and the racial distinctions that cause universal corruption in the world, they have been condemned also. And there is no lawful basis of one man's superiority over the other that has been educated. And Allah has invited us all towards faith and belief and to adopt righteous and pious behaviors. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu la tuqaddimu bayna yadillahi wa rasulihi wattaqullaha innallaha samiyun alim. Allah says, is addressing all of us, and Allah says, O you who have believed, do not put yourselves before Allah and His Messenger, but fear Allah. Indeed, Allah is hearing and knowing. So in this verse, all of us and all the reciters of Quran, they have been taught a manner regarding Allah and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There can be different things which we learn from here. Is the first thing which we can gather from here is that people are the companions in the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were being taught the manner to respect and to regard Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is that when they were walking and they were accompanying Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam while he was walking, they should, out of simple and sheer respect and regard, they should avoid walking ahead of him. And not only does this give us teaching regarding Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but also teaches us indirectly to behave with our elders, our parents, teachers, scholars, with their due respect and regard. And the second thing which verse indicates indirectly is a very, very important message is that we all the followers of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we should not exceed or we should not go beyond what is ordered by Quran and Hadith. Like, the first thing which it means is that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has made certain things, has announced and declared certain things as halal and permissible, then we should take them as halal. But we should not go about allowing other things which are not halal as halal. Similarly, what Quran and Hadith, they announce and they declare as unlawful or prohibited or haram, we should take it as haram or prohibited, and we need to stay away from it and all of it and refrain from it. But what we need to refrain from is at the same time also that we should not start making other halal things haram also. Which Allah has announced halal will be halal, and what Allah has announced haram will be haram. We will not declare and decide what is halal and what is haram out of our own fabrications and our own concepts, because the right of announcing permissible and impermissible, lawful and unlawful, halal and haram is specifically just limited to that with Allah Almighty. Similarly, the verse also teaches us that when Quran, Hadith, or Sunnah, they instruct us to do something. That is, Allah commands us and tells us to do a righteous deed and promises a reward for that righteous deed as well. Then we need to do what? We need to do that. We need to adopt all of that, and we need to strive and struggle for obedience of all of that. But just that, we should not fabricate concepts of good deeds being rewarded ourselves if Quran and Hadith does not tell so. Similarly, if Quran, Hadith, and Sunnah says a don't, stops us from saying something, we need to stay away from them. We need to refrain them. But nothing more than that should we label as sin. Nothing more than what Quran and Hadith has labeled as sin, we should go on labeling sins, go about labeling deeds as sins ourselves. So you know what? Actually, this verse is stopping all of us from indulging in is all forms of innovations, all forms of concepts of deeds being rewarded in the sight of Allah, which are not actually mentioned in Quran and Hadith, but are all what? But are all a fabricated concept. So the verse is actually stopping all of us to indulge in all forms of innovations and bidah. As Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said, كل مختصات بدعة كل بدعة زلالة كل زلالة في النار. That all forms of created, fabricated, falsified concepts of reward and virtuous deeds, they are all what? They are all innovations. They are all bidah, and all bidah is what? It is misguided, and all misguided deeds lead to what? They lead to fire. Allahumma ajirna minan nar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us recognize, register, and accept out of the deeds which are actually not what have been taught to us by Quran and Hadith, but are falsified, fabricated innovations, and stay away and refrain from all forms of innovations. Similarly, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been reported that in a tradition, he said that anyone who will honor or respect the one who indulges in innovations, he said, فَلَيْسَ مِنَّا, they are not from among us. That is a person who is committing and indulging in innovations. According to the words of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he will not be one of the followers of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam clearly announced and he declared that he will be the first on the day of judgment to reach, and then he will reach on the river of Qasr, and then he will provide water to his followers, and all those who will gain and who will get the water of Qasr, they will never feel thirsty again, and all those who will be deprived of it, their thirst will never quench again. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam further mentioned that there, standing on his river of Qasr, he will recognize a few bondsmen. They will be out of the Ummah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he will recognize them, and he will see and realize that the angels will be stopping them from proceeding towards Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he will ask the reason that they are my followers, and why are they being stopped to come close to me? And he will be answered and informed that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you don't know. After you, behind you, they were who invented, who created or fabricated such and such innovations. So that is why, while during the teachings of Quran and our sessions of the learning of Quran, we and all the scholars do insist and do urge upon all the people to stay away from innovations, because they will lead to what? They will lead to the people being deprived from the water of river of Hawthor, river of Qasr, and they will lead to the believers being deprived of the intercession of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And these intercessions, if somebody will get indulged in, will lead to what? Will lead to the person going astray and being misguided, and all the good deeds will be wasted. So that is why we need to recognize them, and we need to be mindful, and we need to refrain from them. May it be in the form of worship a few nights, or fasting for a few days, or spending charity in few specified days, with the concept and assumption that if all these worships, may they be physical or monetary, but if they are done on certain specified dates, the reward would be greater as compared to other days. Although, despite the fact that Quran, Hadith, and Sunnah has nowhere in any tradition or verse reported that doing any of these supererogatory worships in any forms will be rewarded with a greater reward on those days. So like worships of the night, the supererogatory worships on the night, they have been highlighted very clearly according to the verses of Quran and traditions of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah says in Quran in Surah Fajr, wal fajri wal ayalin ashrin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sworn by the 10 nights. And which 10 nights are these? These are the 10 nights of the first 10 nights of the month of Zilhajj. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself, he stood up long hours in the supererogatory salah of these 10 nights. And similarly, is the night of power, as has been mentioned in Surah Al-Qadr. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has guided all of us that you try to find and you try to acquire the night of power or the Laylatul Qadr in the odd nights of the last 10 nights of the month of Ramadan. And it has been reported by the Ummahatul Mumineen that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to stay up himself, and also used to ask and urge his family members in Ummahatul Mumineen to stay up and worship and make supererogatory salah in these nights. So these two are proven by Quran, Hadith, and Sunnah. So any other night other than that, if a person just stays up or stands in worship of Allah in any form, expecting and assuming that this night's worship, he will be rewarded more than any other night. And this is a fabricated concept or innovation, that this will be what? This will be a sin of innovation. Trying to sort and trying to work for gaining reward, on the contrary, the person will end up in gaining sinful acts and sinful deeds. So this is why we need to understand. And similarly, the fasts proven by Quran at the month of Ramadan, which are definitely obligatory. And we do learn from traditions that there will be a door. There is a door in Jannah, which is known as Babu Siyam, through which only those who used to fast will be allowed to enter, and they will be called, invited to enter through that door. So you know what will happen. We need to remember the fasts which are proven by Sunnah, other than the obligatory fasts of Ramadan, like fasting every Monday and Thursday was the Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as he said that my deeds of the bondsmen, they are presented to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala on Mondays and Thursdays, and I want and I desire that when my accounts and my deeds are presented before Allah, then I should be in a condition of fast. And then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has advised, and he himself has proven by Sunnah, that he used to fast on every 13th, 14th, and 15th, that is the Vait days, Ayamul Bays, of every month. And we have been promised by traditions that that any person who fasts every month throughout the year, every month he fasts for these 3 days, will be rewarded by the reward of a person, as if a person has been fasting throughout the years. And if you work out mathematically also, this works out, because all the followers of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they have been promised a minimum of 10 times reward, as in the verses of Quran, Allah says, Ashra Amsaliha, and also was Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam promised 10 times reward on the night of Mi'raj. So fasting three fasts, going with three fasts every month will be what? 3 multiplied by 10 is 30. And if the person continues this act throughout all the 12 months, then this will be what? Like fasting the whole year. Similarly, the fast for the month of the first 10 days of Zilhajj, they have been proven by Sunnah. And as Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has told all of us, that after the month of Ramadan, there is no month other than the first, no days other than the first 10 days of Zilhajj, that whose worships, nights worships, and the fast of the days is more light and pleasing for Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. And Allah has also sworn by the name of these 10 nights. So the ninth of Zilhajj is so excellent as far as fasting is concerned, that it will be a source of expiation of all the sins of the previous year and also for the year which is coming later on. And then fasts of the 9th and the 10th of Muharram, that is the fast of Ashura, they are proven by the Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the fast of Muharram 10th has been promised as expiation of the sins of the previous 1 year. And then there are the fasts of the month, 6 fasts, any 6 days of the month of Shawwal. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has promised that if any person, after completing the fasts of the month of Ramadan, may they be 29, may they be 30, but after completing the fasts of the month of Ramadan, he fasts his supererogatory fasts in the month of Shawwal, that he will be like a person as if he is Samud Dahar. He has been fasting for the whole of his life if he continues these fasts of Shawwal in all his life. So, but other than these fasts, which are proved by Quran and Sunnah, there are no days. There are absolutely no days in which fasting has been promised as a greater reward as compared to any other day of the week or the month or the year. So imagining that if a person fasts on any days other than these specified days of Sunnah and Quran and thinks and imagines and assumes that he will be getting a greater reward, then this is what? This is a fabricated concept, and it has no basis as per Quran and Hadith, and this is innovation. And this person fasting purely out of the desire of being rewarded will end up what? Will end up with the sinful act of innovation, adopting an innovation. Allahumma la taj'alna minhum. And similarly, spending charity in certain specific days when Quran Hadith has not explained them to be so more virtuous, or all the customs which have been prevalent in the society at the time of the death or at the time of the funeral or the burial of the deceased. These also hold quite a few innovations which we need to stay away from. We need to recognize them and to save ourselves from kullu bidatin zalala. O you who have believed, do not raise your voices above the voice of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or be loud to him in speech like the loudness of some of you to others, lest your deeds become worthless while you perceive not. So this verse is again teaching a respectful manner to the companions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is an interesting incident of a companion, Hazrat Sabit bin Qais radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When he listened to this verse and he heard that the verse say that any person whose voice is louder than that of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his gathering, then all his deeds will be wasted and they will be worthless. So when the manner of the companions was that when they used to listen to or when they used to learn a verse of Quran, they always used to make a self-analysis as to what they were doing regarding the commandment and order and do and don't of Allah. Where did they stand? How were they behaving and relating to these orders? So when he made a self-analysis, he realized that when he was in the gathering of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then his voice always used to be louder than that of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he happened to have naturally a high pitched voice. So now, realizing the punishment for this, he was so very upset that he just like got bedridden with stress. And a few days passed that he had not attended the meetings of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam found out about it, and he sent one of his companions to inquire why wasn't he coming and attending. And there he told Hazrat Sabit, he told the reason why he was so upset, and he had fallen sick because of that. And when the information was passed on to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he consoled him. And he told him that the worst was for those who spoke out loud just out of disrespect to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so he was content and he was consoled. Indeed, those who lower their voices before the messenger of Allah, they are the ones whose hearts Allah has tested for righteousness. For them is forgiveness and great reward. Indeed, those who call Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from behind the Hujrat, min wara il Hujrat, from behind the chambers, the apartments, most of them do not use reason. And if they had been patient until you could come out of them, or it would have been better for them, but Allah is forgiving and merciful. So here, these two verses are in reference to the Bedouins, the illiterate people, the tribesmen of Banu Tamim. They had come as a deputation towards Medina. And when they came towards the Masjid-e-Nabawi, they started calling out Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with loud voices from outside the apartments. This was dishonoring, this was disrespectful, it was an ill manner, and it was a bad conduct also. So they have been advised to correct their manner for the respect and the regard of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not only that, for also for his comfort. He might have retired, he might be relaxing, and so they've been instructed that they should just sit and wait till Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out of the apartment himself. Verse number 6, O you who have believed, if there comes to you a disobedient one with information, then do what? Just believe him spot on? No, do what? Investigate, lest you harm a people out of ignorance and become over what you have done regretful. So the background of this verse is an incident in the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Muslims, they were blessed with victory in the expedition, in the battle of Bani Mustalib. The battle of Bani Mustalib, Muslims were victorious, and the people of Bani Mustalib, they accepted Islam. When they embraced Islam, so obviously being a part of the Islamic Republic of Medina, they were supposed to pay zakat. Now, after a year passed, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent one of his companions, Walid bin Utba, as a zakat collector to get zakat from the leader of Bani Mustalik, that is Haris bin Zarar. Now, Hazrat Walid bin Utbah, because of some reasons, he got scared. He got scared to go and ask for zakat from the leader of the tribe. And he came back without going to Haris bin Zarar and asking him for zakat. He just didn't go there. And he came back without doing that and gave a false report that Haris bin Zarar had refused to pay zakat. Now, when Prophet ﷺ was given this piece of information, he ordered to prepare an army to attack Haris bin Zarar and Bani Mustalik, because according to the teachings of our religion, there is a war. There is a war against all those Muslims who are in an Islamic state, but they still refuse to pay zakat. Now, preparations for attacking and the preparations of the army to attack Bani Mustalik, they were in progress. That in the same interim period, Haris bin Zarar, who had been waiting for the collector to come so that he could hand him over the zakat, when the collector did not come, he came himself and he brought his zakat. So these were the verses which were revealed in this background. And the lessons we learned is, the first is that all the piece of information, any piece of information or any news which we receive should be what? It has to be verified. It has to be counter-checked before we believe and before we react and respond according to it. And similarly, we also learn al-ajulatu min ash-shaytan, that all forms of indecent hastes is not liked and it is disapproved, and it is what? It is a manner of shaitan. So Muslim needs to be tolerant, patient, cool, and moderate in his response. And know that among you is the messenger of Allah. If he were to obey you in much of the matter, you would be in difficulty. But Allah has endeared to you the faith and has made it pleasing in your hearts and has made hateful to you disbelief, defiance, and disobedience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala endear to us our faith and bless us with steadfastness of faith and belief, and make disbelief, defiance, and disobedience hateful for all of us. Those are the rightly guided. Allahumma ihdina siratal mustaqim. It is as bounty from Allah and favor, and Allah is knowing and wise. Verse number 9. And if two factions among the believers should fight. Now here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving a guidance to all of us regarding a specific situation. And what this specific situation is, when there is a mutual disagreement, when there's a mutual disagreement or a fight between two Muslims, two Muslim brothers, two Muslim families, two Muslim neighbors, two Muslim sects or factions, or two Muslim countries, even as a matter of fact. And these Muslims, they get a daggers drawn. What should we do? Allah says, but if one of them oppresses the other, then fight against the one that oppresses until it returns to the ordinance of Allah. And if it returns, then make settlement between them in justice and act justly. Why? Indeed, Allah loves those who act justly. So a fair and a just manner has been taught to all of us when we come across or we encounter a disagreement and fight between two factions of Muslims. Now, before proceeding, I would want to compare the current state of affairs. What is the normal practice in such a scenario under the current conditions? People, what usually do is that when they see two people fighting, they just let them fight. People just let them fight and they just pass by, saying things like, let them fight, let the fight carry on. And no one just seems to be bothered. No one just seems to have the time and the patience. No one just seems to be cared. And they just come out saying, to hell with them. Why the hell should I intervene? Let them fight their matter and let them fight out their matter and settle out for themselves. And the other behavior which we normally come across is silent spectators. just standing, seeing, enjoying the whole activity, and that's it. And the third and the worst behavior is, the third category is the party of Shaitan, who starts when sees two people fighting. They start like the party of Shaitan. They instigate. They instigate both against each other, causing the matter to flare up even more. Rather than cooling it down and making the situation, they start making the situation even worse and even more bitter. So this is normally what we come across with, but being a mu'min, we have been instructed to refrain from all the above behaviors and do what? Try to make mutual settlement for this. Do what? Fight against the oppressor and try to stop the oppressor. And if the oppressor stops, we just have to make a mutual settlement and decision by being just fair and just a decision. And why do we need to do a fair and a just decision? Because we want to be among those whom Allah loves. Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbaka wa hubba man yuhibbuka wa amara allazi yuballighuni hubbaka. And now here in verse number 10, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells that you have been instructed about this manner of settling fights or disagreement between the Muslim brothers. Why? Because the believers are but brothers. So make settlement between your brothers and fear Allah that you may receive mercy. So Allah says to maintain the mutual love, fraternity and brotherhood, you need to make settlement. Muslim brothers, Muslims are all brothers of each other with mutual feelings of love, care, sincerity, generosity. And this is what is desirous state of affairs in a Muslim community. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has guided all of us towards this Muslim brotherhood and fraternity, because this verse is what establishes a universal brotherhood of all the Muslims of the world. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has been reported to say, Hazrat Jarir ibn Abdullah, he says in Bukhari, he reports that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said he used to take a pledge from me on three things. A pledge taken by Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on three things, that I will establish salah, and I will continue to pay zakah, and I will remain a well-wisher for every Muslim. So this is it. Being a well-wisher, a caring, loving, sincere, generous Muslim brother for the rest of the Muslim brothers of the community is as important as salah and zakah. And then it has been reported in Musnad Ahmad that Prophet said, to abuse a Muslim is sinful and to fight him is disbelief. So it is sheer disbelief when we start fighting with Muslims. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates in Muslim and Tirmidhi that it was said that the life, property and honor of every Muslim is forbidden to every other Muslim. Similarly, Hazrat Abu Sa'id Khudri radiallahu ta'ala and who reports in Musnad Ahmad that it was said that a Muslim is a brother to the other Muslim. He does not treat him unjustly. He does not leave him alone and he does not dishonor him. There is no greater evil that one should hold a Muslim in contempt. Hazrat Sahal bin Sa'ad Sa'adi radiallahu ta'ala and who he reports in Musnad Ahmad that it was said, a believer's relation with the community of believers is just like that, just like the head relates with the body. He feels their afflictions as the head feels the pain of every part of the body. And another similar narration explains that the believer's example in the matter of the mutual love, relationship, and compassion with each other is the state of the body where when a part of it is afflicted, the whole of it is afflicted with fever and restlessness, and it has been reported in Bukhari and Muslim both. In another tradition, it has been reported that it was said that believers are with one another like the bricks of a wall, so that each is strengthened by the other. So the Muslims of the Ummah, they have been likened in this tradition as the walls. they unite with one another, they stay united, and they unite to make, to raise a wall of protection for their religion. And remember, in this wall, the between the bricks, the cementing substance is the mutual love and the mutual caring and sincerity between the Muslim brothers is what is the cementing substance for the bricks to make this wall for the Ummah. And in this wall, there are some bricks which are going to be at a higher level, and they're going to be bricks which are at a lower level, but all of them are going to be equal. They're going to, all of them are going to play an equal role in protecting Islam and the religion of Islam. And moreover, even if just one brick slips out, this will give way to the enemy to attack the religion and to attack Islam. So is the importance of each and every Muslim for the Ummah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Verse number 11 is an extremely important verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing all of us. Oh, you have believed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to all of us. You believe in me and you obey me and you follow my orders and commandments. So now, oh, you believers, come. May I polish your manners. May I refine your etiquettes. May I make you more refined, polished, good-mannered, righteous, pious believers. An extremely important verse regarding the teachings of the teachings about the manners and the mutual social dealings for all of us to make the believers come up to the level of what? Ruhama abainahum, as they have been taught previously in the last verses of the previous surah, the traits of the companions of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the followers of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has been mentioned as what? As rohama abainahum, that they had a mutual, merciful, kind, and a generous and a sincere relationship. So now in Surah Hujrat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving the do's and the don'ts to guide all the believers to come up to the level of rohama abainahum. And these are the guidances to develop mutual bond. Of what? Innamal mu'minuna ikhwa, that they are what? They are brothers to each other. These are categorical don'ts for the mutual mannerism of all the Muslims and how important good manners are. Before I go through all the verses with the don'ts of Surah Hujrat, I would want to highlight the importance of good manners in our lives and in the life of any follower of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Regarding the manners of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, Inna qala ala khulukin azweem, that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there's absolutely no doubt that you were at a level of excellence, at a level of excellence of good manners and good behavior. And Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she was asked about the manners of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she inquired as if she was surprised. And she said, haven't you ever read the Quran? Haven't you ever read the Quran? And then she said, kana khulukuhu al-Quran, that the conduct, the manners, the behavior of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was what? It was a model of Quran. And that is why, with these excellent models of conduct, of behavior, of manners, is he being made as role model for all of us, as Allah has said in a verse of Surah Ahzab, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. How important good manners are and excellent manners are. Hazrat Abdullah bin Amr radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Bukhari and Muslim that it was said, Inna min khayarikum ahsanakum akhlaqa, the best of you are those who possess the best of manners. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Bukhari that it was said, Akmal mu'minina imanan ahsanuhum khuluqa, the believers who possess the best manners and morals are most perfect in faith. So you know, there is a definite distinct relationship between belief and faith. He who has a perfect belief definitely will have good manners. And on the same basis, who possesses good manners will be a perfect believer also. It has been reported by Hazrat Abu Darda in Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi that Prophet ﷺ said that on the day of resurrection, the most weighty item in the scale of deeds will be what? Salah? Zakah? No. The most weighty item in the scale of deeds will be good manners. And then there was a person from the tribe of Muzana. He came over to Prophet ﷺ and he said that some of the companions said that Messenger of Allah, of the things, which is the best of the things? Ma khayru ma urdiya al-insan. Which of the things is best which a man has been bestowed with? Prophet ﷺ said, "Qal al-khuluq al-husn, good manners." So the best thing which we have been bestowed upon is what? Good manners, good morals. We're even superior to this. Means what? All this highlights what? That good morals, good manners, staying away from bad manners and ill-mannered behavior is even superior to faith, to prayers, fasting, zakah, and hajj. Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she reports in Abu Dawud that it is said, a believer with good manners and good moral disposition gets the same reward. Just listen with an open mind, gets the same reward as he who spends his night in prayer and observes the fast during days always. A person who perpetually fasts and a person who is in a state of supererogatory salah throughout the night and doesn't sleep. This is like next to impossible. This is humanly impossible. No person can be doing that. But a person who just behaving the whole day when he is awake, behaving the whole day with good manners and good morals will be rewarded as if the person who is doing all this. Hazrat Maaz radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he reports that the last advice given to me by Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when I had put my foot in the stirrups of a mount was, he said, make your manners good for the people. That is, behave well with them. And similarly, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that inna awla an-nasi bi al-muttaquna man kanu haythu kanu. That he said that much closer to me are the people who fear Allah and observe piety, whoever and wherever they may be. And this will be a source of nearness to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it has been reported by Hazrat Abdullah bin Amr radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Bukhari that he said, nearest to me, inna man ahabbikum ilayya ahsanukum akhlaqa. Nearest to me, the nearest to me and the dearest to me, where? On the day of judgment, the nearest and dearest to me out of you will be those who have the best manners. And for regarding himself, he has been reported in Mu'tah that he said that I have been sent down. Why? Qala bu'istu li'utimma husnul khalaq. I have been sent down by Allah to evolve moral virtues to the highest perfection. And that is why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to stand in front of a looking glass or a mirror, he used to say, supplicate, Allahumma ahsanta khalqi fa ahsin khuluki. And this has been reported by Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that he used to say, O Allah, you have by your grace made me a good body, make my morals good as well. So this supplication basically gives us what message is that, number one, it teaches us that we need to acknowledge. We need to acknowledge, Ahsanta khalqi, that you have made my body, my face, my appearance, you have made it very nice. You have made it in perfection. And you have blessed me with a beautiful face and a beautiful body. So this is gratitude to Allah. And then the supplication definitely teaches all of us to be mindful about our manners more than being mindful of our looks, of our beauty, of our elegant dresses. Be sensitive about all the spots of bad manners and ill-mannered behavior on our conduct, rather than being sensitive on the stains of our dresses. We need to be careful. We need to be sensitive and mindful about the creases about the creases on our forehead when we are frowning with anger. But we need to be more careful about these frowning wrinkles and these frowning as compared to the wrinkles on our face or on our skins. Because Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was continuously mindful of his manners. And you know, to be mindful of our manners and conduct and morals, what we need to be, we need to have a remarkable self-control of is our tongue. For good manners, the most important thing is to keep control and to keep hold of our tongue and not let it loose. Hazrat Sufyan, he asked Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that which is the most dangerous among the things in respect of which you have the fear concerning me. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, thereupon he held his tongue between his fingers and he said, the greatest danger is from it. So this is the most dangerous part of the body. Hazrat Abdullah bin Amr radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Tirmidhi that he said, whoever observes silence will attain salvation. And similarly, Hazrat Uqba bin Amir radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Musnad Ahmad and Bukhari, what is the secret of salvation? He was asked and he replied, keep your tongue under control and let there be room enough for you in your house and shed tears over your sins before Allah Almighty. Similarly, Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he quoted that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, shall I not guide you, Abu Zar, the two qualities that are very light on the back but are very heavy on the scale? And he said, certainly do. And then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, long silence and good character. By him in whose hand is my soul, mankind can do nothing to compare with these two. So this is what we need to remember and adopt. Hazrat Abu Sa'id Khudri radiallahu ta'ala and who reports in Bukhari that it was said that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam reported that when a person gets up in the morning, then all the limbs humble themselves before the tongue. They humble themselves before the tongue and they say, fear Allah for our sake. For we are dependent on you. And if you were straight, we will be straight. And if you go crooked, we will go crooked also. Hazrat Sahal bin Sa'd radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Bukhari that it was said, whoever undertakes to guard his tongue and his private parts, I will take for him the responsibility of Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us take care and guard our tongue and help have control of our tongue. And then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked about the deeds, the righteous deeds Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pleased with from his bondsmen and all the righteous deeds which would lead to Jannah. And he made a very lengthy sermon and he was like saying that, may I also tell you of the heads of matter and its pillar in highest peak? They said, do. Hazrat Muaz said, do that. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the head or the upper part of faith is Islam, and its pillar is prayer, and the highest peak is jihad. And then in the end, he said, may I tell you of the thing upon which it all rests? That is, that may I sum it up for all for you? And they said, do that. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam then held his tongue between his fingers. And then he said, keep check of it. Keep check of it. And Hazrat Muaz radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he immediately added that, will we also be accountable for what we talk? Will we be held accountable for what we say and we converse and we talk? And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam immediately answered it. He said, people may be cast head foremost into hell, mainly because of their careless conversations. Allahumma la taj'alna minhum. Speech, we know, the ability to speak and to express ourselves by our word of mouth, allamahul bayan, is no doubt a greatest blessings of Allah. But remember, this no doubt is a blessing of Allah, but I do definitely always feel that tongue is a two-sided sword which we have been blessed with. Because the sword when it goes out of control, it hurts, it injures the feelings, the honors of those around us. So we need to do what? We need to keep in control. We need to keep it under control. And we can all realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided us with all assistance to control this loosely moving about tongue. The tongue is tied at the root. It is strongly tied at the root, and there's just one end free to move. And even this free tip of the tongue is firmly, it is firmly harnessed with the frenulum of the tongue. And the tongue is then located in a box, which is what? The denture of the teeth. And finally, the tongue being encircled with the denture of the teeth, finally, it is closed. The box is closed. The lid is closed with the lips to keep it tightly and to keep it under check and control. But how pathetic, you know, really how pathetic that a loose piece of flesh, few inches loose piece of flesh, would just move freely, and it would not be possible to control it by a human being like 5 feet or 6 feet tall. Shame. Shame on whom? The person or his tongue? Obviously, the person, 5-6 feet tall person, not being able to control a 5-6 inches loose piece of flesh. What Allah says very clearly, وَمَا يَلْفِزُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. Whatever you have uttered from your mouth, whatever word, whatever part of speech which comes out of your mouth, there are very attentive, conscious recorders to put it down, to pen it down. Statistically record all things which you said and you talked and you conversed. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has warned all of us, a man carelessly, a person carelessly says something on account of which he will be made to fall in the depth of hellfire more than the distance between the east and the west. Similarly, another tradition explains that a person carelessly talks, displeasing Allah, taking it as a trivial affair, on account of it, he will be made to fall in the depth of hell, equal to the journey of 70 years. Allahumma ajirna minan nar. So that is why, to improve on our manners and to help us acquire control of our tongue and to not let it move about loosely in loose conversation, here in the next following verses of Surah Al-Hujrat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be giving us certain don'ts, la, regarding our conduct and behavior. Allah says, O you who have believed, let not a group of people do what? La yaskhar qawmun min qawmin. Do not let a group of people ridicule another group of people. Why? Perhaps they might be better than them. Perhaps they may be better than them. No, let women ridicule other women. Perhaps they may be better than them. And do not insult one another, and do not call each other by offensive nicknames. Wretched is the name of disobedience after one's faith. So in a state of faith, doing all these three things which Allah has made Allah and don't do, Allah says, this is wretched in the name of disobedience. And whoever does not repent, then it is those who are the wrongdoers. Allahumma ja'alni min at-tawwabina wa ja'alni min al-mutatahhirin. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna min al-khasirin. So now I will start explaining the don'ts. Is the first is la yaskhar. Don't ridicule, don't mock, don't make fun of anybody else. Like don't make a fun of any other nation. Like there are people making a fun of certain group of people, their color, their small eyes, how black complexion they have and how small eyes they have. And even certain nations, they are ridiculed of regarded having a low IQ and whatnot. And then, you know, after a general note, Allah says, let not any women ridicule any women, because this is a specific note for women, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that they are free, pensive mind, and they are expected to indulge in this activity much more than any other one. So a specified, highlighted, directly addressing order for the women of Islam. Making fun of anybody else, mocking, and then ridiculing anybody, how disliked it is. It has been reported in a tradition that Prophet ﷺ said, I would not ridicule anyone, even if I am paid a huge amount for doing so. And has also been informed by traditions that Allah has taken it as His responsibility that a person who ridicules anyone will not die until by the order of Allah, he will be subjected to the same condition and others will ridicule him. Astaghfirullah Rabbi. Person making fun of others, person laughing on others because of certain issue, Allah has taken charge of it, that the person who used to make fun will be subjected to the similar thing he used to make fun of. And then before his death, people will make fun of him also regarding his problem and his issue. Now, what we need to relate is that generally, who are the people who make fun of others? Generally, they are people who have a superiority complex. They are proud and arrogant people, and they just ridicule and laugh at others. Or they may be people with suffering from any form of inferiority complex. They cannot compete with those ahead of them. They cannot go ahead of those who are successful, more successful as compared to them. So they do what? Just simple leg pulling, trying to bring them down by making fun of them, just trying to disgrace them or trying to belittle them to get one up. And then what type of behavior, who generally comes up with making all this mocking and everything is generally small minds, who have nothing better to do. They just mock around people. As you must have heard that it's said that small minds discuss people, greater minds discuss ideas, and the greatest minds, they act in silence. So it is small people with small minds, free people with free minds and nothing better to do. They start mocking people and they start making fun of people. And what generally is made fun of? What do people mock? What do people ridicule generally is? Generally, somebody's style of dressing, talking, walking, somebody's conversation, proficiency in a language, wrong pronunciations are generally made fun of. And the worst form of ridiculing is making fun of somebody's physical appearance. The eyes, the hair, the nose, the lips, anything of the sort, the color, the height, the bodily structure. But what we need to remember here is that making fun of somebody's physical appearance, bodily appearance, facial appearance is actually, na'uzubillah, what? It is not making fun of that person himself. It is na'uzubillah, summa na'uzubillah min zalik. It is making fun of the creator. Astaghfirullah Rabbi min kulli zambin wa atubu alayk. It is making fun of, na'uzubillah, the khaliq, the khalaq, or the al-musawwir. But from the whole of this discussion, I would want to further clarify that this by no means implies that even laughing and enjoying is not permissible in Islam. Laughing at others is not allowed and permissible, but laughing with others is very much permissible. On a light note, having fun and entertainment and talking with each other, like there are incidents in life of Prophet ﷺ, Hazrat Halima, She was the foster mother of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and she came over and she asked for a camel. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would kept on insisting and on a lighter tone that he would give him the offspring of a camel, the son of a camel, or the baby of a camel. And she was like, she was not happy about it. And she was slightly annoyed and she left. And then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, while she was leaving, he got hold of her hand lovingly. And then he was on a lighter note, he added, "What? Oh, my mom is a camel, not the offspring of a camel." So it was just like making a light note humor. And that was it. Similarly, there's an incident that Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he accompanied Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and they went as guests. And the host, they brought fresh dates. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was really fond of dates and he was continuously eating dates. And what he was doing was that he was placing the seeds in front of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And when all the dates finished, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he commented that, "Ali, you ate so many dates," because obviously there was a heap of seeds in front of him. "Ali, you ate so many dates." Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he came up with a very witty answer and he said, "Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I ate all those huge amount of dates. You also ate up the seeds with the dates." Allahu Akbar. So this is, we can laugh and there can be humor in our lives, but it has to be positive. It doesn't have to be hurting and critical and negative. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the next thing is, وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ means basically three don'ts. Do not try to find faults with other people. Do not be complaining and cribbing and grumbling to other people around you. And do not taunt other people, saying hurting things. Don't taunt other people. So these are three don'ts. I repeat again. Don't try to find faults with other people. Don't be complaining and don't be taunting. So the first is avoiding to finding out other people's faults. Because when a person tries to find out or is looking for the shortcomings and faults and the sins of other people, this is a disliked behavior. So what we need to do is, rather than trying to waste our energy and time finding out faults with other people, we need to do what? We need to do a self-analysis, a strict, a firm, a fair, and a very tight self-audit and self-analysis to check of our own faults and to confess them, to repent, regret, and seek forgiveness, rather than to find out faults of other and waste our time and efforts doing all that. And then the second law from Wala Talmizu Anfusakum is what? Don't be complaining. Always grumbling and bickering and bothering and complaining is what? It just makes other get fed up of our company. And this doesn't increase our bond of love. And people tend to get more and more hateful for us. And people tend to start avoiding our company and start disliking our company. So being complaining, generally people think that if we complain, we might tend to rectify the situation and improve the bond in the end. No, it does not. It worsens the bond. It worsens the bond and it makes the person even more hateful and disliked and loathed. And the third don't is, that don't talk, don't taunt. Taunting and saying things which are hurting and which makes somebody's respect and honor, makes the person being dishonored, and things which hurt the person and makes the person cry, we need to refrain from all such sentences also. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that, وَلَا تَنَابَزُ بِالْأَلْقَابِ. Do not call each other with offensive names. So this is also a la and a don't of Quran, calling each other by bad names which have been associated because of the height, the color, because of any quality or manner of the person associated that bad name, or even nicknames. As has been reported in a tradition, that Prophet ﷺ said that it is the right of every Muslim over his Muslim brother that he should call him by the name he likes. So this is a right. And remember that there are sometimes the nicknames, especially for children in their childhood. And when they grow up in adulthood, when they are called by the name, this nickname of the childhood, children, people generally don't seem to like it. So even if the person who is being addressed dislikes to be called by a loving nickname, doesn't like to be called by a simple nickname also, then even that should be avoided. And then in the next verse, number 12, Allah further guides us that, oh, you have believed, do what? Allah says, اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن, that you need to stay away from what? Refrain from what? Zan, from assumption. Why? That some assumptions are what? They are sin. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving a don't of the verse, telling that this indulging in this don't is sinful. And what is this? Assumptions. Making negative or bad assumptions. What is assumption? It is an opinion which a person develops without a base, a baseless impression or opinion which is developed without any proof, without any verification, without any logic. This opinion is known as an assumption. These opinions or these assumptions, they may be negative or positive, they may be bad or good. And what are we being stopped from is making negative assumptions or making bad assumptions, because they are what? They create. They create a mutual misunderstanding and they create mutual grievances. What the verse is actually instructing all of us is that we should avoid keeping and holding grudges, holding and keeping grudges and grievances against each other and against our Muslim brothers and sisters, harsh feelings against each others to protect the mutual bond and to protect the mutual love and brotherhood of Muslims. So that is why we have been told not to have bad assumptions which will lead to mutual grievances and grudges. I can relate an incident in the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which has been reported by the companions, that they were attending a meeting in the mosque. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting amongst all of them when he looked at the door and he called out aloud that the person who will enter from the door of the Masjid an-Nabi will be one of those who will be of the people of Jannah. And all of the companions, they fixed their gaze on the door, and who entered was Hazrat Abdullah. All the companions were very envious of him. And the narrator explains that he was in a condition that he had made wudu and water of the wudu was trickling down from the parts of the body. So the next day, he said, it's reported for the next day, the same thing happened all over again. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the same glad tiding, and Hazrat Umar, Abdullah bin Umar came, walked in, and he was again in a similar state, and the state of envy further multiplied. The third day, the same thing happened all over again. It is like a hat trick. Three consecutive days, a hat trick, when the companion gets by the word of mouth of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself sitting in the Masjid an-Nabawi, the glad tiding of entering into Jannah. Now, you know, there was the state of envy of the companions reached its peak. And one of them explains, the one who is narrating the tradition, he explains that for me, I was envious to him. And so when the meeting dispersed off, I followed him to his house and I stayed over at his place as a guest. He entertained me for 3 days. And the companion said that my purpose of going to his house was that I wanted to stay with him, spend some time with him, see him over the day and night, how he behaves, what his conduct is, what his morals are like, what his ethics are like, how does he worship, what is his salah, and how is his remembrance and gratitude, all his members' manners he wanted to see and observe so that he could copy and imitate them and be deserving of the glad tidings also. So the third day, because as we learn from the traditions, is that the right of the guest on the host is for 3 days. So he was hospitable to him for 3 days. And on the third day, when he asked the reason why he had come, the companion who narrates, he explained the whole occasion and whole sequence of event which he had seen in the mosque. And he asked him, "Now you tell me. You tell me which out of your deeds are you expecting that you will get the maximum of reward and you think will be making you deserving of this glad tiding from the words of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam." He just made a self-analysis, and in the beginning, he was so humbled. He was so humbled that he could not identify anything. But if any one of us, just imagine any one of us in the position, we would come up with 101 things. "Oh, I offer 5 salas a day. I recite this much of Quran every day. And now I can understand the Quran. And now I started covering my head. And now I take away." And 101 deeds would we think of. But he was so humble, he just couldn't think of anything in the beginning. And when the guest was about to leave, he called him back, and then he answered that there is one manner which I adopt daily before I go off to sleep and before I retire, that I make an accountability of my heart, and I just try to see that, do I have any grudges or grievances or harsh feelings against any Muslim brother in my soul? So it is needed to do what? To purify our souls. Rabbana la taj'alna ghilla lil-lazina amanu is the supplication which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned regarding all those who will be the inmates of Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us purify our souls against any bitter feelings of enmity, any harshness, any grievances, any grudges against the Muslim brothers and sisters. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Wala tajassasu." Don't go about carrying on a CID in the people's lives out of sheer curiosity. Don't spy. Don't spy. Don't poke into others' matters. Don't peek into their private lives. Listening to somebody's conversations, overhearing a telephonic conversation purposely, reading a letter, reading a message, an email, whatever, wherever, but interfering in people's personal lives. Do not grope after the secrets of people. Search for their defects and weaknesses. Do not pry in their conditions and affairs, whether it may be out of sheer suspicion or for causing harm to somebody with an evil intention or for satisfying one's own simple curiosity. This is all forbidden. This is Allah. This is a don't of Quran. As Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has been reported in Abu Dawood, it was said, "Oh, people who have professed believing verbally, but faith has not entered your hearts, do not pry into the affairs of Muslims. For he who will pry into the affairs of the Muslims, Allah will pry into his affairs. And he whom Allah follows inquisitively is disgraced by him, even in his own house." Allahumma la taj'alna minhum. And then it has been reported in a tradition of Abu Dawood that it was said, "If you start prying into the secret affairs of people, you will corrupt them, or at least drive them very near corruption." And then another words of hadith, Prophet ﷺ said that when you happen to form an evil opinion about someone, do not pry about it. And Prophet ﷺ has also warned all of us that the one who saw a secret affair of somebody and then concealed it as though he has saved a girl who had been buried alive. So this is the reward of a person who sees something wrong and covers it up. as has been informed in a tradition that a person who helps a bondsman, Allah will help him. A person who covers up a bondsman, Allah will cover him up. And a person who forgives a bondsman, Allah will forgive him on the day of judgment. There's an incident in the life of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu that one night he was going about in the streets that he heard a person who was singing in his house. And Hazrat Umar became curious and he climbed the wall. And there he was. He saw that the person was just not singing. There was wine and there was a dancing girl, a dancing maid there also. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was very angry and he shouted at the man saying that, "Oh, enemy of Allah, do you think that you will disobey Allah and Allah will not expose your secret?" The man immediately replied, "Do not make haste. Do not make haste, O commander of the faith. If I have committed one sin, you have committed three. Allah has forbidden spying and you have spied. Allah has commanded that you should not enter houses by doors and you have entered it by climbing over the wall. And Allah has commanded that one should avoid entering other people's house without permission, and you've entered my house without my permission." And Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he accepted what he had wronged. So this is what Allah is stopping all of us. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has also said that if someone peeks in someone's personal letters, if a person just peeks in someone's personal letters, it is like that he has peaked in hellfire. Remember, this is bad taste. This is bad manners. And this is what we need to do is what? We just need to mind our own business. And then after this, one of the last but not the least, Allah says, giving us a do or don't, wala yaghtab, don't backbite and slander. What is backbiting and how bad it is, we learn from multiple traditions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One being reported by Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Muslim, that it is said that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in a meeting and he was among the companions and he said, "Do you know what backbiting is?" And he said that backbiting was what? When a person talks about his brother in a way that hurts or harm him, this is backbiting. The companions asked that it will be backbiting even if that thing is actually, that evil is actually present in him. That is what we are mentioning in his absence. If that evil deed or that sinful behavior is actually being practiced by him, and then we are mentioning, will that still be backbiting? Prophet ﷺ said, it will be backbiting only when the evil is present in him. While if it is not present in him, it will be slander, which is even more worse than a backbiting. So this is what it is. We, in the absence of any Muslim brother or sister, we talk about the person in a manner that if the person finds out that we were commenting like that, the person will be hurt, the person will feel bad, and the person will be upset. Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala reports in Abu Dawud that it was said that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told all of us that during Miraj, I passed some people whose nails were like, they were red like copper, and they were scratching their faces and breasts with them. And I inquired that who were they, that they were being given such a terrible punishment was being inflicted on them. And Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam replied that they were the people who used to backbite. They were the people who used to backbite, and they used to eat the flesh of men in their lives. That is, in their absence, they spoke ill of them. And they played foul with their reputation. So this was the punishment which was seen by the eyes and heard by the ears of whom? As-Sadiq al-Amin. Hazrat Abu Sa'id Khudri and Hazrat Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they report in a tradition that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that backbiting is worse than adultery. Ashaddu min az-zina. Ashaddu min az-zina. It is even worse than adultery. How? He added that if a person unfortunately commits adultery, he can be forgiven by Allah if he offers repentance. But A person who does backbiting will not be forgiven until he is forgiven by the person he had spoken ill of behind its back. So this is it. How conveniently people commit backbiting. Can we imagine of committing zina? Can we imagine of committing illegal, illicit physical relationships? No. We definitely realize how unlawful and how prohibited and how major a sin it is. And just imagine, would a mother be fine? Would a mother be fine with the fact that her daughter should know that she is an adulteress? Or would a father be comfortable knowing that the daughter is an adulteress? No, definitely no. This would be like killing themselves. And they would be so, so upset. But here in this community, in our society, a mother is fine when she is backbiting in front of her daughter. She is backbiting about her daughter-in-law in front of her daughter. And a father seems content and doesn't get upset when the daughter comes backbiting about her husband in front of the father. He's content. So this is what we need to realize, that backbiting is even worse than adultery. It has been reported by Hazrat Abu Barza radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Abu Dawud, the Prophet said, O people who have affirmed faith with the tongue and Islam has not yet entered into their heart, do not speak ill of Muslims behind their backs and do not pry into their secrets, for whoever does so, Allah too will treat him in the same manner, and whoever will be treated like that from the side of Allah, he will be made lowly and debased by him in his own house. So backbiting, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in a gathering and there was bad smell, and he asked, do you know of what thing is this bad smell of? And he said that this is the smell of all those who backbite. And we learn from traditions that there were two women and they met each other and they were in a state of fast and they had a conversation in which they indulged in backbiting. And then when they went back home, they had severe and intense pain in their stomach and they were like about to pass away and they were close to death. And the issue was brought to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they have pain in their stomach, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called them, and then he asked for a bowl, and then he asked them to throw out, and when they vomited out what? Fresh red blood and raw meat. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed them and told them, look, this is the raw meat of your brothers you had consumed when you were backbiting. In future, refrain from backbiting. And you know, in these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has likened the person who is backbiting with the person who would like to eat the flesh of his brother when he is dead. Why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given this example, likening it with the act of backbiting? Is because, you know, the person who is absent from a place and he is being talked ill of in his absence is similar to a person who is dead. The person who is absent cannot protect his respect and his honor. Similarly, very much similar, like a dead person cannot respect his honor and his respect. So the next thing which I would want to highlight is that listening to all these verses of Quran and listening to all these traditions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we would definitely, inshallah, we will definitely refrain from all forms of backbitings. But what do we do? What do we do when we are in a gathering where other people are backbiting? We will obviously not be indulging into it, and we will obviously, inshallah, in future, not be a part and parcel to all those conversations. But what do we need to do? Just keep silent? Okay, fine, better. But still better to do what is to talk and to save and protect the honor of the person who is being tried to be disrespected and whose honor is being made fun of while backbiting by the Muslim brothers. as Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has promised that when a Muslim brother protects the honor of his Muslim brother in his absence, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants his face protection from hell fire. And then a specific type of backbiting is when backbiting is done with intention of creating a misunderstanding or fight between two. And this is what this is, which is known as Allah has, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, la yadkhulul jannata qati. A person who is a slanderer will not enter into the paradise. Allah, help us all control our tongue and help us all put ourselves and subject ourselves to self-control and stop indulging in all these activities of conversation. O mankind, indeed we have created you from male and female and made you people and tribes that you may know one another. Indeed, the most noble of you in the sight of Allah is the most pious, is the most righteous of you. Indeed, Allah is knowing and acquainted. So here in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining that the origin of all the human beings is the same, that they have all sprung from one man and one woman. So since the origin is same, so there is no need to be proud and vain and arrogant and pompous because of a superior origin or a tribe or a clan or a family or a creed. Because, you know, most of the forms of arrogance do have a source and they do sprout up from this arrogance of being proud of one's own origin. And similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the only thing which is more noble in the sights of Allah is inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. The most noble in the sight of Allah is not on the basis of a family or a caste or a creed or a color or a tribe, but on the basis of piety, on the basis of their pious and righteous behaviors. And we also understand and gather from this verse is that in Islam and even on the day of judgment, there will be no form of any form of gender discrimination. And here the superiority and the excellence is on the basis of what? Moral excellence and excellence of piety. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has here explained that the differences of all these castes, creeds, and tribes, they were just made as points of recognition, of identification. And there's nothing, there is no truth beyond this, and there's nothing more to it. And we need to just stay humble and we need to refrain from any form of arrogance on the basis of caste, creed, or color. And this is exactly what Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has reported all of us also, as it's been reported that he had a sermon which was made on the conquest of Makkah. And he said, thank God who has removed from you the blemishes of ignorance and its arrogance. O people, men are divided into two classes, the pious and right, who will be honorable in the sight of Allah, and the sinful and vicious, who are contemptible in the sight of Allah. Whereas all men are the children of Adam alayhi salam, and Adam alayhi salam was created by Allah from clay. This has been reported in Tirmidhi. And similarly, on the occasion of the farewell pilgrimage, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam announced that he said, O people, be aware, your God is one. No Arab has any superiority over a non-Arab, and no non-Arab has any superiority over an Arab, and no white has any superiority over a black, and no black has any superiority over a white, except on the basis of taqwa and piety. The most honorable among you in the sight of Allah is the one who is most pious. So this is the teaching of Quran and Hadith for all of us. Similarly, in another tradition, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that you are all the children of Adam alayhi salam, and he was created from dust. Let the people give a boasting of their ancestors, otherwise they will stand more degraded. they will stand more degraded than a mean insect in the sight of Allah. And then another verse of hadith, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has been reported to say, Allah will not inquire about your lineage on the day of resurrection. The most honorable in the sight of Allah is the one who is pious. Allah does not see your outwardly appearances and your positions, but He sees your hearts and your deeds. And what is in the heart, as Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had said, taqwa hahuna, taqwa hahuna, taqwa hahuna. And Allah says, wattaqullaha haqqa tuqatihi. Allahumma aati nafsi taqwaha. Allahumma aati nafsi taqwaha. Allahumma aati nafsi taqwaha. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-khuda wa tuqa wal afafa wal ghina. Allahumma tuakhir qalbi minan nifaki wa amali minan riyai wa lisani minal qazabi wa aini minal khayanati innaka ta'lamu man khayanatil aini wa ma tuhfis sudur. Allahumma alhimna rushdan wa aizna min shururi anfusina. Allahumma arinal haqqa haqqan warzuqna tiba'a. Allahumma arinal batila batilan warzuqna jtinaba. Allahumma inni a'uzu bika min munkirat al-akhlaq. Allahumma inni a'uzu bika min munkirat al-akhlaq wal-a'mal wal-ahwa'i wal-adwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us check our conversations, control our tongue. Allah, help us all stay mindful of our manners. Help us be polite, courteous, soft-spoken, and well-mannered. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may we not be of those who are ill-mannered and hard-hearted and harsh. Help us stay away from all forms of foul conversations, of backbiting, slandering, mocking, taunting, dishonoring, disrespecting, calling by bad names. Allah, help us refrain from all these mannerisms. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive us all if we spoke wrong. Forgive us all of all we spoke wrong. Forgive us all if we hurt someone. Forgive us all if we made someone cry. Forgive us all if we were a source of disrespect or dishonor for someone. Allah, help us. Help us purify our hearts. Purify and keep our hearts purified from mutual grudges and mutual grievances and mutual harsh and hard feelings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us cleanse and purify our hearts and fill them up with your love and with the love of your beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and with the fear of hereafter. Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbaka wa hubba man yuhibbuka wa amal allazi yuballighuni hubbaka. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين آمين ثم آمين.